And so I'm excited to introduce Moon Duchin, who is a mathematician who works on problems in geometric group theory and geometric topology, but is currently using some of that and a lot of other various mathematical theory to study very practical and urgent issues such as redistricting and gerrymandering. And more generally, Chris Moore asked me to mention that she's the leader in applying mathematical analysis to the process of democracy. We're very happy to have her here. And Melanie Mitchell told us about her wonderful podcast with Steve Strogas that I also all invite you to listen to because it's really great. And it's certainly the best one in his podcast series. She is otherwise a professor at the Department of Math at Tufts University, where she leads the metric geometry and gerrymandering group. And she also directs the program in Science, Technology, and Society, and is a senior fellow at the Fish College of Civic Life. And this reflects her longstanding interest to problems in social epistemology, civil rights, politics, democracy in general, and this interest develops simultaneously with math since her BA studies, which are in math and women's studies. So today she'll be talking about not gerrymandering, or she'll be touching on gerrymandering, but the main story is about the new census policy to try to avoid identifying individuals in their data sets by adding random noise to their data. And so this has many implications. It's also complicated, and she'll explain how this works and also what are the implications for redistricting. So take it away, Moon. One just a note about the questions. So feel free, she said, feel free to, you know, unmute yourself and interrupt, or post your question in the chat and I will be monitoring and then interrupting Moon with your question when I see it.
Okay, so, actually, thank you. I will try to set it up so I can see at least some of your faces at the same time as I'm talking. Okay, screen share look good?
Yep.
Okay. All right, so I call this talk Privacy and Census Data, Math Meets Policy. And this is joint work with a team of people, Aloni Cohen, Jan Matthews, Bhushan Suwal, who's here on the call today. Hi, Bhushan, and Peter Weiner. And I'll sort of jump in and tell you about what I wanna do, which is to take a look at this plan for a new disclosure avoidance mechanism that's happening right now in the census that's about to be released. And I really wanna think about both the math side of it and kind of what we can say about how it works and what its implications will be. I'm also really interested in the users and the end users and their use case. And because I run a lab that focuses on redistricting, because redistricting is actually like the original purpose of the census, it's a very natural bridge from the math in differential privacy to the question of redistricting as a use case. Okay, so yeah, this is something that folks may or may not have known, but the census is called for in the Constitution itself, and it's called for this purpose. In other words, we're supposed to enumerate the people in all the states, and those numbers are used to apportion the House of Representatives. So as you all may know, but maybe could be reminded, every state gets two senators, but a variable number of members of the House. It's been over 100 years that the House has had a fixed size of 435 people. And so the question is how to distribute those 435 seats to the states. And that happens per census count. Okay, so disclosure avoidance is about releasing census data in a way that doesn't compromise the privacy of individual people's responses. And that's a, you know, it's a requirement for the Census Bureau to protect privacy. That's actually also written into federal law. The problem is that this way that the census is planning to do it, which I will explain, called differential privacy, is freaking people out, broadly speaking. There's a worry that it will so-called erase marginalized communities whose census response was encouraged at great effort and expense, as I say on the slide, and that it will make it harder to use the Voting Rights Act. And I'll tell you a little bit more about each of those concerns. And you know, before I get into some of the details of how this works, let me say, I prepared this talk for a wide range of different kinds of people. I really do invite you to ask either clarifying questions or slight reorientation questions if there's a piece of this that I'm not quite speaking to that you'd like me to say more about. Okay, So what is the plan for this new disclosure avoidance? So differential privacy, or DP, is being implemented, and that might go by the slogan, noise you can prove things about. Okay, so what is differential privacy? So first, I guess, common misunderstanding, people think that DP itself is an algorithm to, you know, protect data. It's not, it's a mathematical definition. In other words, it's a property that an algorithm can have. So what is this property? I'm not gonna dwell on this, but I'll just say very basically, if you have two data sets that are person level data sets, then let's suppose D and D prime differ by one person, say being removed or added from D to make D prime, then you call an algorithm epsilon differentially private if the probability that when you query the algorithmically altered data and ask a membership question, the probability that you get a yes to that membership question is related by an inequality to the probability for the perturbed data set. And the coefficient depends on epsilon. And I didn't put any more details in this definition because it's actually a really broad framework and I just wanted to give you the big idea. So the big idea is that your ability to learn things from membership queries doesn't change that much when you take a person out or put them in. Okay, so that's what's called differential privacy. Okay, and the way this is gonna be applied in the census is that I'll talk a little bit more about the structure of how the census releases data. And then you'll see that even though the census collects person level data, they release aggregated data. And so by noising the aggregated data that's released, you can accomplish this epsilon differential privacy. So this number epsilon is gonna come up a lot. Okay, we're gonna talk about epsilon. We're gonna call it the privacy budget. It's a kind of funny turn of phrase, but it's what comes with the theory for differential privacy. So we're gonna adopt that language. And it goes kind of in the opposite direction that you'd think, or at least that I would think as a mathematician. I would think that epsilon going to zero is the effect disappearing, but it's the other way around here. So when epsilon equals zero, what comes out of the algorithm is all noise and has nothing to do with the input D, okay? And the data fidelity increases as epsilon goes to infinity. And as epsilon approaches infinity, no change is made to the data at all. So it's maybe the opposite direction than you think, but it's a slider from all noise to just giving you back your original data, okay? So intuitively, it's called a budget because you're gonna have some choices about where to place your budget. And that's the way people talk about this. Where should you allocate that budget? Intuitively, the idea is that you put the biggest part of epsilon in the place where you need the greatest accuracy. And I'll keep explaining what that looks like. Any questions so far?
I have a question. Mm-hmm. I'm curious, because the way you described budget really intrigued me. So I'm wondering, like, where do you think this language comes from?
Yeah, I think, so who are the inventors of differential privacy? They are theoretical computer scientists, such as Cynthia Dwork and her collaborators. And so I don't think they were thinking about this budget in economic terms. I think they were just thinking about it as like, you have a fixed amount of stuff you can allocate. And so the term budget just comes from that metaphor. but I don't know, I can ask Cynthia, I'm supposed to talk to her on Thursday. okay, so, but actually, you know, but that does bring up an important point here. I was sort of referencing this in a slightly flip way in the abstract. Like this idea comes from theoretical computer scientists, i.e. the kind of people who work more with chalkboards than they work with computers, right? and so it's these provable properties that are like the engine here for differential privacy. And it's getting used in the census, which is an extremely high stakes application, right? And it's gonna be an amazing test of theory meets practice, right? To go all the way from the chalkboard to this like data delivery mechanism from which flows not only redistricting and apportionment of political power, but also funding. Federal funding is tied to census counts and a whole range of programs are administered in a way that's tied to census counts. It's just an extremely high stakes use case. This is why it's so interesting to see the census get this done so fast. It might have been more cautious for the census to take another 10 years to plan this and roll it out for not 2020, but 2030. But it got put together pretty quickly, and I want to tell you about what this looks like when you look at it up close. I'll mention quickly, there's a second census product, less well known than their decennial release, that's called the ACS, or the American Community Survey. And it's based on a survey rather than a complete enumeration. It asks a lot more questions, so it's maybe a lot more sensitive. It asks you about your income and other kinds of questions that are more sensitive. The plan was initially to start using differential privacy in the ACS also immediately. And then all the kind of pushback that came around these announcements caused them to push that 5 years. So now there's a 5 year delay on noising the ACS in this way. We can come back to that, but I think that was an interesting development. Okay, so let me tell you a little bit about the census. Again, maybe like super familiar to all of you, but worth a little reminder at least. So the Census Bureau has geographic units at various resolutions that cover the country. So in 2010, that was organized in the following hierarchy, and this is sometimes called the central spine of the census data. So the nation is split into states, split into counties, and then tracts, block groups, and blocks. And I put down the exact counts of those per the 2010 census release, and so and the branching factors that you get just by dividing. Okay, so we already knew there were 50 states in the nation, but it's kind of interesting that there are 51 block groups per, sorry, blocks per block group, but only 3 block groups per tract. So there's this kind of interesting hierarchy. One of the people at the Census Bureau that our group has gotten to know in recent months, Mike Ratcliffe, he's a senior geographer there. It's been great to talk to him and get a little bit more insight into these programs. I, as someone who's had a longstanding interest in kind of philosophy of science, I was interested that he thinks of a big part of his job as the conceptual work of census units. Like, what does it mean to be a block group? So just so you know, if you didn't know this already, there are fantastic people at the Census Bureau doing hard work to make these units kind of conceptually coherent and to sort of think about what they mean. In 1940, there was a simpler central spine, nation to state to county to something called enumdist or an enumeration district, which is a little bit like today's tracts. Reason 1940 is important for this project, there's this mandated 72-year waiting period on releasing full census data for privacy reasons. So 1940 is the last census for which we can actually see all of the person-level data. We can do stuff to it, do experiments with it. Okay, here's a picture. So this is Missouri, and so is this, and so is this, and so is this. This is to give you a sense of some of the nesting that goes into census data. So I talked about the central spine, that's the top path here, but then there are a lot of other ways to kind of branch in census data. For instance, counties are divided into something called county subunits, which has a somewhat different meaning. This is a fun slide. So this is just borrowed from Nick Freeman, who made this, I think, 2014. So I mentioned there are 11 million census blocks in the last release. So it turns out fully 40% of them have no people at all. Zero people live in 40%, nearly half of the census blocks. So that raises, again, some questions about what census blocks mean. But they're units which in a city might actually be city blocks, and in rural areas, you know, have a somewhat different meaning. But they're a partition of the entire country, including a lot. Take a look at this picture and you'll see they also partition a lot of the water, but not the Great Lakes. You know, so it's interesting what the census blocks do and don't cover. Something else that I like about this picture, again, thinking about sort of what does it mean to be a census block, notice that you can actually make out a number of state borders in this picture, which is kind of interesting. And what that suggests, among other things, is that, like, you know, North Dakota has its own way of handling census blocks that's a little bit different from neighboring states. Okay, anyway, there's so much richness to census data, and one of the rewarding elements of our work in my lab over the last couple of years has been getting to know the census data better and the remarkable people who produce it. Okay, here's a famous diagram produced by the Bureau itself that shows you some of its nesting structure, and you can see the central spine visible down the middle, and lots of other complexity in there as well. But we recently learned that the geographic hierarchy is being rethought in some interesting ways that do impact this project. So instead of having this one size fits all spine that I was just describing a moment ago, the census is looking into possibilities to have regionalizations, regional variations. I find this fascinating. I live in Massachusetts, I'm in Cambridge, Mass, and I bet nobody here, I bet there are people on this call who've lived here or around here before, and I bet you probably don't know what county Cambridge is in. Am I wrong? Anybody know? Right. But is there anyone on the call who's lived in Austin, Texas? Okay, if you did, and I asked you your county, oh, wait, I see a yes. Anyone know what county Austin's in?
They say Travis.
Yeah, exactly. Mwah, brilliant. This point works every time, okay? If you're in Austin, you know you're in Travis County, and you probably know who the Travis County clerk is because she's amazing. But you know, around the country, the role of counties in not only the way people think about where they live, but also in the way services are delivered, varies greatly. And that's the point that the census is trying to respond to here by having a hierarchy with some regional variation. So counties are important in some places. American Indian and Native American areas are important in other places. New Jersey, it's all about townships. And it just really varies kind of around the country what the functional hierarchy is. And you'll see why the hierarchy is so important for this discussion of disclosure avoidance as I go. I can see that things are coming up in the chat, but Mirta, you're going to have to tell me what they are because I can't see.
Apparently Wilco, which is a bag, right?
It is.
It's from Travis.
Oh, there you go.
Right, Caitlin? I guess that was the latest comment.
Okay, so what does all this have to do with disclosure avoidance? Here's the point. So the census's algorithm for doing a differentially private noising is called TopDown because it runs down that hierarchy, whatever the specified hierarchy is, from the top to the bottom, and I'll explain more what I mean. So, okay, let me introduce the term histogram bin. So there are these 11 million census blocks, and in each block we need to count people. And so we have a number of residents, and at the simplest, they're labeled as male or female, they have an age, they have a race, they have an ethnicity. And so you should think about each of those as a bin. In other words, in the census block where I live, the 52-year-old Black non-Hispanic women, right? That's a thing you can count. And the census release is gonna have a number of those. There will be a number of 52-year-old Black non-Hispanic women in my census block, okay? Noise is gonna be added to every single number. Okay, and the way that noise is going to be added is that a random variable will be drawn and added to the number. Okay, so you start with a whole bunch of numbers, like just a dizzying array of numbers, and then you just tweak them all, you perturb them all. All right, so the way this is going to be done is that it's going to be drawn from a Laplace distribution. So here's Wikipedia, I don't know, some internet picture of Laplace distributions. You're probably a little bit more used to thinking about Gaussians, which are bell curves. These are a little pointier, okay? And they just have some nice properties for the point of view of this algorithm. I'll show you what some provable properties are. And so we'll take that epsilon budget that we had and we'll distribute it over the levels of the hierarchy. So the standard census hierarchy had 6 levels. So I'll take my epsilon budget, which is a real number, like maybe 2, okay? And then I'll partition 2 as the sum of 6 non-negative numbers. And that's my budget at each level. Okay, so maybe my block level budget is like 0.4, it's some number like that. And then I'll plug that in here and that'll tell me which one of these colored curves in the picture to draw from. I'll pull from that. They're all centered at 0, and they're pretty pointy, so they're peaked at 0. And so I'll draw a small random number, and I'll add that to my count. Okay, that's the basic mechanism here. Everybody cool with that? All right, so then we do something called post-processing. So here's my like cartoon picture of post-processing. So there are a bunch of equality and inequality constraints that I need my answer to satisfy. So an equality constraint is that things add up right, consistency in the hierarchy. So if I have 3 census blocks in a block group, then the counts in those blocks have to add up to the counts in the block group. That's hierarchical consistency. That's an equality constraint. But there are also inequality constraints, such as, what's an example of an inequality constraint? I can't have, you know, a household. There's also households structure in the census data. I can't have a household consisting of 23-year-olds. There are various kinds of, that's why I'm calling them plausibility constraints. Okay, there's various kinds of inequality constraints that go into that.
There is a clarifying question from a little bit before. Are the noise stars for each number in the data set independent of one another? Yes.
They're all independent. You're drawing, yeah, that's what I meant there by IID. They're independent and identically distributed. So for everything at a particular level in the hierarchy, I draw independently from this Laplace distribution. Okay, and then you should think about the color coding in my picture. It's like, imagine that red is for drawing on block groups and green is for drawing on tracts. So there's one epsilon parameter for each level in the hierarchy. And then I draw independently from that all across that level. Yeah, thanks for asking. Please just ask questions. Okay, so because plausibility is controlled by equality and inequality constraints, the feasible region is a convex body. And so what I'm trying to illustrate in this picture is that in principle, you start out with real data, ground truth data, that satisfies all those constraints. Then you add noise and it might leave the feasible region when you add noise. Like in particular, oh, here's a good one. I could turn something negative. Maybe there were no people of a particular kind and I added a negative number because all of these Laplace distributions are centered at zero. And so certainly it's going to be an inequality constraint that you can't have a negative count. Okay, so maybe I fall out of the feasible region. So post-processing is just closest point projection back to the feasible region. Okay, so that's the sort of two-step dance of differential privacy in the census. You noise and adjust. Okay, questions? Cool. All right, that's the plan that's happening to the census data. And then here's the worry. Maybe you saw this particular op-ed when it came out in the New York Times in February. Changes to the census could make small towns disappear, right? And so at a minimum, this noising has some bad optics because you guys probably noticed there was a lot of political contestation around the census in the last year or so, in which in particular, the government via the Commerce Secretary wanted to add the question, are you a citizen, to the census. It's not currently in there. It's in the ACS, but it's not in the census. And there was a lot of worry that this would cause people to get nervous about filling out the form and not fill it out. It went to court. It went up to the Supreme Court. And then in what seems to have been a close call, the court decided that the census couldn't ask people the citizenship question. But in that whole kind of chilling effect around the conversation, there was a lot of worry that we would get an exacerbated non-response problem from vulnerable and marginalized groups. And so already a lot of work and thought and money has been going into outreach in, you know, undercounted, you know, communities that are known to be undercounted in their census response. And then the optics of just changing those numbers after you've worked so hard to get them aren't great, right? Okay, so now let's talk about redistricting, and I'll be really brief. So there's a law that says that data has to be released in a manner suitable for redistricting, and that's called PL94171, which is also the name of the data release. Okay, so public law 94171 says you have to give the states information they can use to draw their district lines. What is that information? I already alluded to it. You have to know the population. You need to know by sex, by race, by ethnicity, and so on. There are 63 races in the census. Did you know that? That's a fun fact. And it's because there are six different yes or no questions. Are you white? Are you black? Are you Asian? And so on. And you can answer yes or no to any of those six, but you can't say no to all of them. So you get 2^6 - 1, or 63 races. Okay. Ethnicity is treated not as a race, but as a separate binary question. Are you Hispanic or not? Okay, and so you start to see just how many so-called histogram bins there are. There are a lot of different combinations. And all of this information, according to PL94171, has to be released at the census block level. Okay, I already mentioned this is how we give out congressional apportionment. Here's a fun fact you might not have known. So congressional districts in nearly every state are made of whole census blocks. So a district is just a subset, it's just a connected subset of census blocks. What's kind of amazing is that the practice in almost every state is to make the number of people in these districts differ by no more than one person, which is crazy, but that's the practice. That's the common practice. Why is this crazy? The census accuracy was never good enough to support this practice in the first place. Also, blocks, which are sort of best thought of as like the littlest pixels, remember if 40% of them have no people at all, and a lot of them have one person or three people, so they're these tiny little pixels. When you break down to something that granular to draw your districts, it's an invitation to gerrymander. Okay. There's so many rules and we don't have time to talk about them, but districts are supposed to be contiguous, so connected. They're supposed to be compact, meaning nicely shaped, and to comply with the Voting Rights Act, which I'm about to tell you about, among a host of other kind of often vague rules. So what is the Voting Rights Act? Well, that's the topic for a whole, you know, semester course at least. But in brief, it's a law passed by Congress in 1965, back when Congress was capable of passing laws like this. So it was signed by LBJ. It was supposed to last for just 4 years, but we still have it on the books. It's been extended and sharpened over time. What does it say? Well, the part of it that's still in force, which is section 2, says that the system of election has to provide qualifying minority groups with an opportunity to elect candidates of choice. So the checklist for that is called the Jingles factors, and I'll talk about that in a second. But just so you know, there used to be, in this picture I'm showing section 5, which is no longer in force, it used to be the case that all of the green and pink areas of the country had a stronger, had a, you know, a higher hurdle to clear, something called pre-clearance. They had to ask permission to change any of their voting rules at all, but that was wiped away in 2013 by the Roberts Court. Okay, but what's left is section 2, which is this opportunity to elect. Okay, so how does that work? Well, these Jingles factors, the things that you need in order to press a VRA case, you have to do some statistical assessment to demonstrate that voting is racially polarized. In other words, you have multiple races and they vote differently in such a way that the minority is blocked from the opportunity to elect their candidates. Without getting into it, I'll just say, summary here, TLDR, you have to show that you have a minority group on whose behalf you're pressing a lawsuit, that it votes cohesively and is blocked by the majority. So what does that look like? It's easier with a picture than by trying to spell it out. So this is a very simple plot, which is close to the state of the art in racially polarized voting analysis. It's called ecological regression. It's just a linear line fit to the data. What's the data? I'm showing you Chicago. This is the 2015 Chicago mayoral election. And the dots here are the 2000 precincts in Chicago. Every precinct, I've plotted its percentage of Hispanic residents. Again, that's from the census. Okay, so the percent of the precinct population that's Hispanic. And on the other axis is the percent that voted for Chuy Garcia, who was running against Rahm Emanuel that year in the mayoral runoff. Hey, there looks like a pretty strong relationship. Precincts with a higher share of Hispanic voters seem to like Chuy Garcia better, both better than other precincts, and they like Garcia better than Emanuel. Okay, so there looks like a pretty clear pattern. So the point I want to make about a picture like this, how is this used in a VRA lawsuit? The main thing that's read off this picture is the point estimates that you get from where that line intersects its extremes. If you extend the line out to x equals 1, you're getting an estimate for the Hispanic support percentage for Garcia. So in this picture, it looks like that's about what, 78%. Is the estimate. That's the point estimate. Roughly 78% of Hispanic voters preferred Garcia per this model. And then go down the other way, and I don't know, that looks like about 30%. So about 30% of non-Hispanic voters, according to this model, voted for Chuy Garcia. Okay, I'm calling those the point estimates. And this is how, there's another technique called ecological inference. Ask me about it if you care. But this is basically how you go to court and say, hey, there's a group that's not having an opportunity to elect. they clearly have a candidate of choice and that candidate is blocked by the majority. Okay, questions about this? Cool. All right.
Oh, can I ask a question?
Yeah, please.
Maybe I missed it. How do you define what's a minority group? Is it race, ethnicity only, or?
So in 65, the VRA was squarely aimed at African-American voters, but it's expanded a lot over the years. And in particular, in the 1980s, language minorities were added. So now in particular, for instance, there was a lawsuit just settled in the last few months in Lowell, Massachusetts, right up the road from where I sit. And it was a coalition claim on behalf of Hispanic and Cambodian voters. Okay, so the language minority constituted a group that had a cause of action under the VRA. Any other questions about that? Okay.
Oh, question from the audience. Mm-hmm. What was the red, the left edge?
Oh, yeah, okay. So there's kind of three techniques out there. Well, okay, the short answer is the red precincts are the 5% with the highest Hispanic percentage and the 5% with the lowest Hispanic percentage. And they're just in there because sometimes people like to ignore all the inhomogeneous precincts and only look at the most homogeneous ones. This, by the way, if you're interested in this, like we have a Shiny app for doing these plots yourself. You can upload your own voting data and make these kinds of plots and also do the somewhat fancier Bayesian method called ecological inference. Talk to me about it if you want to play with this. Okay, last thing before I get into like our findings is just to say it's been 50 plus years that the Voting Rights Act has been out there. And so there's a lot of case law and kind of legal practice that's built up around the VRA and how to use it. And part of the worry about differential privacy is that it will unsettle some of these standardized legal methods and fictions. So one legal fiction is that the census data is, first of all, gospel. It's accurate, it's perfectly accurate. You're supposed to treat it that way in court. But not only that, you treat it as authoritative for 10 years. Like everybody knows that 5 years after the census was conducted, it's not exactly accurate anymore. But that's how you treat it. You treat the census as the authoritative source for these numbers. For some purposes, you need citizenship data. Like I said, it's not in the census, so you get that from the ACS. But you get it at the block group level and then you have to disaggregate it to the block level. Actually, the point of this slide for the purposes of this talk is really just to say there are asterisks everywhere. There are all kinds of messy data practices that courts have just gotten accustomed to around Voting Rights Act litigation. And so there's just a worry that differential privacy could upset some of this apple cart. Okay, and ask me about any of this if you want. Okay, so this doesn't mean questions from you. This means questions that we asked in this project. Here's what we wanted to know, our aims. We wanted to know what's contributing to the ultimate end of the day levels of inaccuracy after you've gone through the DP machine. So the hierarchical allocation. So first, someone has to pick epsilon for the census, and we don't know what that number will be. As I understand it, there's like a 10-person panel of both like career census bureau folks and some government policy folks who are gonna say, epsilon shall be 0.68. So that number is gonna be set by like a panel of people whose identities aren't known and which considerations they're using aren't known. So that's an interesting factor. We don't know what epsilon will be. But the bureau has to, once epsilon is set by this panel, the bureau has to decide how to allocate it over the levels. So I'm actually gonna ask you just to sort of see if I'm doing an okay job, like, bringing you along with me on this story. I'm gonna ask you to guess, if you want the most accuracy at the blocks, where should you allocate that budget? Okay, so again, remember, where you put the most epsilon, you should get the most accuracy, right? So one naive view would be, you want the accuracy at the blocks, put your whole budget at the block level. But then you might worry, what about hierarchical consistency? I'm supposed to add up to the totals at the higher levels. So if I screwed up those higher level totals, I'm adding up to the wrong thing. Uh-oh, that's not very good. Do you see the problem now? To me, it was totally opaque when I started this, like completely opaque, how you should allocate that budget if at the end of the day you want the best accuracy at the bottom. Okay, so that was one of our research questions. That was a major research question. Second major research question, because I care about redistricting, what aspects of district formation would lead to more error? So are there some ways of drawing districts that would cause lots of error variance for those aggregations? Are there other ways of drawing districts that will mitigate that effect? And then I'll mention the last question here and see if you all have questions about this, questions about our questions. We wanted to understand the effects on these racially polarized voting techniques. So in particular for these line fits that I was showing you a second ago, would you lose the signal of racial polarization? So if you had a high slope, would you lose the slope after noising? Would you like mess with those point estimates too much to like be able to press a lawsuit? Would your opportunities for voting rights action disappear? Those are our questions. Okay, do you guys have any questions about our questions? Cool. All right, so let me tell you what tools we have and then let me tell you what we found. So we work with a number of attorneys who are, you know, civil rights attorneys who are among the people who are concerned about this. And so we asked, hey, can you give us some interesting case studies, like places we should go looking to sort of see what would have happened if you noised the data? We were pointed to this case in Irving, Texas. Irving is in Dallas County in Texas. And there were a few interesting lawsuits, all circa 2010. Here's a particular lawsuit in which the challenge failed on data grounds. Like the data was thought not to be good enough for a voting rights challenge. So we were told that would be interesting for us to look at. Like, would differential privacy have introduced more uncertainty in the data than what already got this case thrown out? We thought that was an interesting case study to look at. Okay. Here's a second powerful tool at our disposal. And I probably should have talked about this earlier because this is the why. Why is the census doing this to us? This is the why. Because if you don't protect the data, you can reconstruct everything. There's so many different, because all of those different queries are available to you, all those different questions you can ask, such as how many 52-year-old Black non-Hispanic women. By asking many combinations of those questions, you can rebuild the input data, which is person level, and you can figure out what every person said on their census form just from the aggregate data. And this isn't just a theoretical possibility. I am pointing you right here to a GitHub repo in which you can do this, okay? And I'm inviting you to check it out. So this was built with the encouragement of the folks at the Census Bureau, because remember, this is their justification for using differential privacy. So they are comfortable having you play with reconstruction. That's the threat that they're responding to. Okay, so what does this particular, so this is with some collaborators of ours based at Columbia. Mark Hansen is a statistician cum journalism professor at Columbia. And his team built this algorithm that, ask me how it works later if you want, but it rebuilds the data. Furthermore, by linking it with commercially available data, they were able to link names and phone numbers to every line in their reconstruction. They tested it out by calling people up in New York City saying, are you so-and-so and did you write the following things on your census form? And they freaked people out enough that they stopped making those phone calls pretty quickly. Okay, so a number that you'll hear, this isn't perfectly accurate, of course, because there may be multiple consistent solutions or just whatever, the algorithm might not produce the perfect reconstruction. But a number that you'll often hear floating around is, I think 17%, that you'll get like 17% like perfect re-identification once you marry your reconstructed data with a commercial data set. Okay, so we had that at our disposal. And then we built a toy model. So we have the actual code from the census. They also have a GitHub repo and they released their code. And Bhushan's one of our team members here who got good at actually running the census code, although it is a little buggy and we're, working with them on some of the issues that we found. But we built a toy model that doesn't use top-down, and so we called it toy-down. What toy-down does is it takes a really simple hierarchical structure like you see in the trees here, and it takes a small number of attributes and it adds noise and it then makes it hierarchically consistent. So this is a means for us to be able to see some of the effects of differential privacy without the full use of the census code, the toy model in that sense. And then looking at the time I have left, perfect. I'll just have time to tell you about our findings. So Bhushan and Peter have been running actual top down, as I said a moment ago. Peter has been running it. He set up his own server to do this. He ran it on 1940s data, and now also on 2010, Bhushan's running it on 2010 reconstructed Texas data. And these are the kinds of, this is just a little snapshot of an actual spreadsheet of outputs. We were experimentally looking to see if we allocate the budget in different ways, how much does it change the answers? Okay, so those are the ingredients, and now I can tell you about our findings briefly. All right, so what are our findings? First of all, not only is this talk being recorded, but these slides are available, and so is a preprint, so just, I'm gonna move kind of fast and just talk qualitatively about what we found. Feel free to ask me any detailed questions. One thing that we did is we sort of were able to like analytically write down, at least for the toy model, how much error variance is produced. And let me emphasize, I'm always gonna be talking about error variance and not error expectation, because since you're drawing from this variable centered, random variable centered at zero, it's always true that your expected error is zero. So it's all about the variance that's producing the observed error in the actual counts, okay? So here's some expression for the data, and in short, what it tells us is that the variance that you get at a node, in other words, at like one unit in the census hierarchy, is given by this expression, which has to do with summing this formula with the epsilons in it. This is where the allocation matters. The epsilon j's are the amounts that you allocate at different levels, with a major discount higher up. Okay, so in other words, the lower levels contribute more to this error variance than the higher levels in this very specific way. You can just read off the formula. So that's one finding. Is there a question about that? I saw something pop up in chat. Okay, I'll ask later.
Yep.
Oh. Yeah,
please. Here's a question. Is the noise added blind to other data available? You could also add noise so that with known data reconstruction is hard.
Right. Sure, there are other ways of adding noise with other kinds of theoretical guarantees. The people who advocate for DP like to say that people are adopting DP so widely because there's nothing else that you can get. Yeah, I don't actually want to wade into the politics of DP versus other disclosure avoidance mechanisms, so ask me later. but basically, there are other kinds of disclosure avoidance. Oh, and I should tell you what the census was doing before they started using DP. They were doing something that I think you'd have to characterize as highly janky, okay? So what they were doing is called swapping, okay? So they would take blocks in which there were small numbers of people, so maybe a block in like Teaneck, New Jersey, in which there's a small number of people. And if there was some risk of like being identifiable, they'd grab a block in Alaska and just switch, okay? And if you go and ask the folks at the Census Bureau, what's the algorithm that you used? They will tell you there wasn't an algorithm, there was a guy, right? So this was this was totally opaque. And so this is actually a huge merit. So I'm glad this came up, right? A huge merit of differential privacy, whatever the other critiques will be, it is totally transparent. You can, not only can you prove theorems about it, you can see the code that they're using to do it. It's totally transparent. And it's adjustable, you can change that epsilon, you can change various implementation decisions year to year. So differential privacy has a whole lot of things going for it. But yeah, okay, some of the kind of inside baseball about why to use this and not other disclosure avoidance systems, let us defer. Okay, let me tell you just briefly about some of our other findings. So we tried to understand the ideal allocation of budget, which I asked you to kind of guess before. Where should you put this epsilon budget if what you care about is accuracy at the bottom? And the answer was, I don't know, a little surprising to me, which is summarized as these plots are very flat bottoms. And here's what that means. What we found is that if you put roughly half the budget at the bottom, it doesn't really matter that much what you do with the rest. You can allocate it equally over the other levels. You can sort of move it around. But the fact that the plots that you're seeing here have a really flat bottom, what those say is once you've set the amount of epsilon that goes to the block level, it's just not that sensitive to what you do with the rest. That's sort of how to read these pictures. That's actually, I think, a really useful finding and one that I know the folks at Census are interested in hearing about from us. Yeah, another really nice aspect of the transparency of this program is that like you can try stuff and then go back and tell them how it worked, and they are definitely actively working out some of these implementation decisions. Okay, and then here's one that I'm extremely fond of. This is our last theoretical finding, and then I'll show you a couple of empirical findings. So this one's super cool, I think. So we wanted to understand if the whole point of top-down is that you can carefully tune accuracy on the central spine, what matters for redistricting is aggregations that are not on the central spine. In fact, aggregations that are made after the census data is released, right? So the census can't like put a lot of accuracy at the district level because the districts aren't made yet. They're made using census data. Do you see what I'm saying? Right? So we wanted to understand what kinds of districts will be less noisy and what kinds of districts will be more noisy. And here's what we found. And again, like this is hard to absorb at the pace that I'm moving, unless some of you probably have already absorbed the slide and proved the theorem in your head. But what this is saying is we have an explicit description of the district error in terms of what I'm calling a parental discrepancy term here. And here's what I mean. Look at this tree. So you should think about this as nation, divided into states, divided into counties, and so on. If you want to know the error at the bottom at a node, what it depends on is you go up its whole ancestry line all the way up to the root, and you look at all the sibling groups that you see. You see what I mean by sibling group? Is that clear from the picture? Right? They share a parent. Okay, that's what sibling means. So you look at all the sibling groups and you just add something up which has to do with how different the siblings are from each other, or equivalently how different they are from the parent, because in this particular weighting scheme, the zeros and ones at the bottom just denote whether you're in the district or not. And everything higher up the tree, the score of the parent is the average of the children. Okay, so that went a little fast, but all I'm trying to say is we're able to like explicitly work out for the toy model how much error you'll aggregate. And it just depends on like your path, your ancestry path up this tree and kind of the sibling groups that you see. And so what we worked out is that the level of error, what it punishes is inhomogeneity in the sibling group. So if you're very different from your siblings, that's costly. It adds up to a lot of error. Okay, so stop and think about that for a second. And it answers the question, what kinds of districts will have the least error? It'll be the ones that are made out of bigger units, because then you'll have lots of homogeneous ones. When you include a bigger unit entirely, you include all of its descendants. And then there'll be zeros at a high level, which means zeros for all descendants. So you won't get those contributions to like sibling discrepancy or parental inhomogeneity or whatever I call it here. The things that will produce a lot of error are where you have like random scatterings of zeros and ones. In other words, the precise pattern that's associated with gerrymandering, right? The one where you like wind wildly in and out of clusters, that's what's gonna contribute to error. So that's nice. That's a pretty cool kind of qualitative finding. Okay. I have more to say about that, but I want to show you some pictures. But this is just illustrating that same point again by saying, just as I said, look at the blue versus red trees. If you take all of a big unit, you're not going to get lower level contributions to variance. You're just going to get a few terms, and the variance is constant with respect to the depth of the tree. But on the other hand, if you sort of take every other node at the bottom of a binary tree, you get an error that grows with the depth of the tree. In fact, it's proportional to 2 to the depth of the tree. Okay, so make things out of bigger pieces and you'll see less error. Make sense? Okay, sorry, I probably went on too long about that. I just have 2 more pictures I wanna show you or so, roughly. Okay, I told you we really wanted to know what happens to these attempts to fit a line to some precinct data. And so this is the actual data from Irving, Texas. The case that was pointed out to us is interesting by the voting rights attorney that we love to work with. And these pictures look bleak. What you see in these pictures is blue is the true data from the census, and pink is the noise data with various kinds of differential privacy imposed, top down. Is this top down or toy down? Bhushan, is this top down or toy down?
This is toy down.
Thank you. Okay, so this is the toy model, but we actually are also doing this with top down. I just didn't include the pictures. So this looks terrible. Differential privacy has ruined everything. It's taken those point estimates at the side and it's moved them by a lot. It's taken those slopes and it's moved them by a lot. This looks bleak. But wait, there's good news. That problem essentially goes away if you remove tiny precincts. The whole driver of the misery in my last picture was if you look at way down at the bottom at the precincts with 0 votes, So precincts with tiny, tiny populations, maybe even zero, that happens, there are precincts with zero population. Then of course, noising changed things dramatically in those tiny population precincts, and it generated lots of error overall. If you simply filter out tiny precincts, suddenly the picture becomes much nicer. Okay, so what's the punchline? To use this regression technique responsibly, you must trim out small precincts. But this was already a problem before differential privacy. It was already giving nonsense results before differential privacy. DP just highlighted that fact, okay? That's the punchline I draw here. I have one more punchline to show you, but any questions about this? Okay. Second, this one's fun. So I mentioned before the talk started that something our group really likes to do is Markov chain techniques for drawing random districting plans. There are various applications for that, but we wanted to understand it in this context. So remember the theoretical result I showed a few slides ago said, if you respect the hierarchy, in other words, if you make things out of big units, then you should expect less error than if you ignore the hierarchy. Or even worse, if you like sort of make a designer district that winds in some extremely motivated way around the terrain. So we were able to test that. So on the left is a hierarchically greedy district. That's me. This is actual Dallas. By the way, Dallas County is nice. It's very nearly a square. This is actual Dallas. and so on the left is a Dallas County Commission district. Okay, so it's a district in Dallas made out of whole tracts, so out of big units. That's hierarchically greedy. And on the right are some districts that are made by our Markov chain methods that are hierarchy blind. They're just made out of census blocks in a fairly nicely shaped way, but one that doesn't pay any attention to which blocks are in the same tract or block group. And what we found is that these have more than twice the observed error than the ones that are hierarchically greedy. I consider this pretty good news because it was, again, sometimes differential privacy will highlight problems that really turn out to be longstanding issues in the way things have been practiced, right? So this becomes an addition to the already long list of reasons that it's good practice to build districts out of bigger units. Punchline of that, block-based redistricting is not justified by population balance, and that was always the case. And so-called fragmentation leads to significantly higher DP error. So the very last thing I'll add to that is, in order to make that observation usable, we decided to sort of name it as a score called the fragmentation score. So this is just reverse engineered from our formula for the error variance. It's that parental discrepancy term that I was talking about before, right? Just add it up over the districts. So this would exactly be the error variance if you had equal allocation of the budgets for levels. And the point is that this provides like a rough and ready, if someone's making a districting plan, we could say, wait, check its fragmentation score. Try to make something with a lower fragmentation score and you'll get more accurate counts at the end of the day. Okay, and that's what I got. So future goals, We're hard at work trying to understand the impact of the household structure. Ask me about that if you're interested. We'd like to compare DP error to sampling error, like from the ACS. Our goals are to make recommendations to the Census Bureau for how they're going to do the hierarchical allocation. We want to reassure VRA litigators and help the Census not get sued. That's, I think, a great goal. And we'd like to help sort of contribute to an updated set of expert practices around the Voting Rights Act. There are a lot of ways that you could help. First of all, I'm really looking forward to your questions, but also that reconstruction code could really use some code review, and I'm sure it has ways that it could be improved. It would be fantastic, but we're a bunch of theorists for the most part. It'd be fantastic if folks want to take a look at and play with the reconstruction code and talk to us about ideas for experiments. So that's what I got.
Thank you very much. Yeah. That's what we have in these virtual times, that kind of applause. Okay, but thank you, that was great. Wonderful talk. Would anybody like to come up with a question before me? Because I have two.
I think Will has.
All right. I was wondering, you were mentioning that you have a toy-down model and then the pull model. Could you say a little bit more about kind of any differences in findings between those two?
Sure. So the Census Bureau, as I mentioned, they have all these kinds of invariants, these household constraints and so on. And in particular, you need to know how people group into households in order to even take the household constraints into account. So the reconstruction code that we use from Hansen's group doesn't include household structure. It's a person level reconstruction. So that means like we're not able in a natural way to take household structure into account, but it's possibly one of the big drivers of the post-process, one of the big contributors to the effects of that post-processing step, right? So I think I would say one of the goals in the way we set up our study is to take all the different, it's so complex, this top down, it has so many parts, and we want to tease apart the effects of the different layers in the reconstruction. Okay, so one of the ways that we're trying to approach that now, so the way the 1940s person level data works is that you get a long string for every person. And that says something about what household they're in. It's got a code. If you parse out the digits in that long string, it tells you their race and their age and all of that information. But the household structure is encoded in that. So we're trying to do a few different kinds of hybrid experiments, but one of them is to like grab 1940s data and reassign the race and sex and age to match our reconstruction, but preserve the household structure from the 1940s data, right? That's one way to like make up household structure that isn't random. And so that's one of the kinds of experiments that we're doing. So I would say top-down is really different from toy-down because there's a lot in there. The post-processing is much more mysterious. Whereas we have total control of what we're post-processing when we do the kind of toy version. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense. You were also mentioning that you would compare in some way the results to the standard errors from ACS. That's interesting. Can you say a little bit more about that?
Sure. So ACS numbers are usually released with margins of error, right? So there are a lot of statisticians at the Census Bureau, and based on their survey methodology, they're actually telling you how much error to kind of expect in their numbers. And so by doing an experiment with differential privacy, we can see how the levels of observed error once you run something through the pipeline compare to the reported error from the ACS. So that's one way to compare sample error to DP error. And then another one, of course, is just to take a data set and for us to sample from it and see how the sample average compares to the full data set and compare that kind of like manual sampling error to the amounts of error that you get from DP.
Could some standard error be used to determine the good epsilon for different regions? Does it say anything about, variance, of course, in particular areas, which would then feed in maybe in the appropriate epsilon or budget that should be
allocated
to different blocks.
The slide I showed you with the whiteboard where the folks at the census were thinking about varying the hierarchy, that blew our mind. We just learned about that. What was that, 2 weeks ago, Bhushan, something like that? It blew our minds because we had been so focused on the central spine. So there's a lot to think about, and ultimately they'll release what their regional hierarchies look like, but not now. And so there's just a lot of unknowns. And we also asked our collaborator at the Bureau, Mike, who's on our advisory board, we asked him the question, will there be the same number of levels everywhere? Will you use the same allocation? They're still figuring all this out. But I'm really glad that they are. Like, I keep saying this, but I do want to be sure to be clear that I'm incredibly impressed with the level of thought, the level of work that went into this. The folks at Census are really trying to get this right, and they have a lot of different metrics of what it means to get it right. They're under a lot of pressure from many different sources. So I really think of some of the work that we're able to do as also translational work from the efforts at the Bureau to some of the stakeholders. I heard this great phrase. So John Abaud is the chief scientist at the Census Bureau these days. And a lot of folks are calling this, sort of semi-disparagingly, John's science project, right? So that there's an attitude in some quarters that, like, you know, this is being done because folks think it's cool, but it, at great risk to sort of high stakes use cases. And I don't think that's quite right. Like, the Bureau cares deeply about these use cases, but there are so many. The census data gets used in so many ways that it's actually hard to kind of, you know, purpose build an approach for all the different use cases at once.
Great. Any other questions?
Beyond questions, I was saying a moment ago, like, is this something that you guys have thought about? And most of you have your cameras off, so I need proof that you're actually here. Something that you've thought about? Do you have any feedback? Do you have anything that you thought was particularly interesting or that we should try? Anything that seemed promising or not?
So Michael Lachman was asking this question about whether the noise added is blind to other data available, and that you could also add noise so that with known data reconstruction is hard. So, and you said it might be something you'd address after the talk.
Yeah. So other data available is pretty hard to control. So like Aloni Cohen, who's one of the collaborators on this project, he's also involved in a project to use Facebook ad data to do the re-identification after you've got a reconstruction. So many of you probably know this, but by like, you can tell Facebook when you go to advertise with them, how many people will I reach if I filter by this, and this? And so if you think about it, those are kinds of, and they're, it's pretty cheap to ask those questions to Facebook, surprisingly cheap. So that gives you a way to link reconstructed census data to Facebook profiles, right? Which is obviously very personalized re-identification. So if that's part of what you have in mind when you say other data available, that would be like total whack-a-mole to keep track of all the different sources of data that can be linked to a census reconstruction. I think that would be really hard because there's so many different commercial data sets available that that seem possible to do this with. But Michael, it'd be great to sort of hear more about like what you have in mind. And I'm interested to hear what kind of data you're thinking of. National Household Travel Survey has household data. Right, but how, yeah, let's talk. I would love to talk to you about that. Linking that to the reconstruction sounds really challenging.
Michael, would you like to unmute yourself and say something? Or? Sorry. Maybe easier.
No. I just used it for household data, so I know it exists.
Okay, yeah, we should take a look.
Moon, I had a quick question, if that's okay. Just wanted to clarify something. So it seems to me like one of the headline kind of takeaways from this talk was that there's something to worry about this finely grained block level organization of the way in which the census collects data. Mm-hmm. But it seemed as though there were sort of two problems, and to me they seemed independent of one another, but I was curious if maybe I haven't got that quite right. There's a kind of epistemic problem, which is that just by having these sort of 1-2-0 person census blocks, you just introduce you know, the possibility of getting like a whole block wrong, and that can sort of percolate up into your sort of overall construction of the census. And then there's this sort of political problem, which is that these single person or sort of low population blocks open the door for gerrymandering, because if the goal is to have congressional districts that differ only plus or minus, you know, one individual, you can very easily sort of snake out these census blocks and get creative in order to have gerrymandered districts that are contiguous and yet highly, you know, gerrymandered and advantageous one party or another. So am I right in thinking those are more or less two separate problems, or is there maybe more of a connection there than I'm grasping? Well,
I mean, no, I would say it's right. Okay, so I got to hear a presentation by Johnny about on this DP effort recently, in which he said, that the pressure to release the data at the block level does come from the use case. And so there's this kind of funny feedback loop happening. Like, why do people do zero balancing? Well, in 1964, the Supreme Court said one person, one vote. And in particular, so that was the first foray into redistricting by the courts, and the court said, balance the population. And then, well, balance the population is great, but how close does it have to be? The way that evolved over the years turned into this crazy practice of one person balancing, because in Veith versus Jubilee, a Pennsylvania districting plan was thrown out for 19-person deviation. It was thrown out. That's crazy. We're talking about districts, congressional districts have like 710,000 people. Maybe at the time it was 700,000. That's a lot of people, right? 19-person deviation. But of course, it was thrown out for 19-person deviation because it was successfully argued that that deviation was masking a racially disparate impact. Right? So the case law is super complicated, but states have gone to zero balancing as safe harbor against one person, one vote. Does that make sense? Right? And that keeps the pressure on the census to keep releasing things at this tiny pixel level, you know, and so on. So there's a kind of feedback loop, I think. And you know, for people like me who really like this STS point of view, science, technology, and society, super interesting to think about the ways that science and bureaucracy kind of interact iteratively. So you have the bureaucracy in some cases drives the social science, but the use cases also constrain the bureaucracy. And it's just a really interesting and complicated history. All to say that, like, Simpson Garfinkel, for instance, who's one of the scientists at the Census Bureau who's working on disclosure avoidance, he gave a memorable talk about a year ago at a redistricting meeting in which he said, that crazy, this is a paraphrase, of course, that crazy thing you all do where you balance down to one person, like, you never should have been doing that with our data. Like, didn't you know? Like, and the way he phrased it was, the sausage always had fingernails in it. It's kind of picturesque. But what he's trying to say is that the numbers were never suited to that application. So there's this kind of funny push and pull between the law, the practitioners, and the bureau. And I think one of the things that I'm being an optimist here, but one of the salutary effects of DP is going to be curing people of the of that balancing practice. We'll see. I should mention, at some point not that long ago, the census was considering not imposing non-negativity. In other words, they were considering releasing the negative numbers that they got after adding the noise. And then people's heads just exploded in like a simultaneous chorus everywhere, and they decided not to do that. But that would have been, from my point of view, that would have been fantastic. Who could have argued that they had to like zero balance by moving negative three people from here to there? I think it really would have cured the habit.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Oh, can I ask another one? So in one of my lives, I'm a survey methodologist. And so actually Bob Rose, the previous census professor, director, was my professor. You know, so let's say that I want to draw a sample, a probabilistic national sample, representative sample from a population based on new census data, which is now noisified. What do I need to know? Like, do I need to do some kind of backward algorithm to get denoisified portions of important groups?
So the census would like you to treat these numbers exactly as authoritatively as you did before.
I see.
That's what the census would like you to do. And they're arguing, and various studies like ours, various other groups are also exploring the question of like whether your answers will be any worse now than they used to be. But that's their hope. Now it is true, as I'm sure you know, that you can sign up to access microdata through the Bureau. So you can, excuse me, I've been talking too much today. But you can, by saying what your project is and signing various kinds of non-disclosure agreements and whatever it is that you have to sign, whatever paperwork you have to sign and whatever approval you have to get, you can go to the Bureau and actually see some of the detailed data if you promise to only use it in certain ways and not other ways. But the Bureau's stance, as I understand it, is that the DP data is going to be just as good for your social scientific applications as it used to be. Maybe even better, because we're not swapping New Jersey and Alaska anymore.
There's that. Better than the algorithm guy. Okay, cool. Okay.
I have a question, kind of like zooming out from this. I'm curious, Moon, like, because you are working at an intersection of math and policy, like how you found this intersection for yourself and what drew you to that space?
Yeah, so I started working on redistricting in 2016 when I teach at Tufts, and my department, the math department, has had a class on social choice theory for like 30 years. And it like came to me to teach that class. So I found myself teaching a voting theory class. And at the same time, one of my lifelong closest friends is the executive director of one of the premier civil rights litigation shops. So Kristen Clark, who runs the Lawyers Committee for Civil Rights, they're one of the great groups that does this voting rights work. And I somehow like it got Kristen to come and talk to my class, which was like amazing. She's a rock star. And of course my students were like checking their phones and you know how that goes. So the confluence of teaching voting theory, having this fantastic civil rights attorney come and talk to my class and say to them in front of me, hey, we're about to have a crisis in the voting rights sphere because all of our experts that we've been relying on for decades, they signed on in the 60s and they're aging out and they won't even probably be around for this census cycle. We have a major shortage of experts. And then the third thing that happened around the same time, I happened to go to a conference of APSA, the American Political Science Association. And I went to a session to hear about one political philosophy topic. And it happened that there was also a talk on the shapes of districts, on what's called district compactness in the same session. So you put those three things together, like teaching voting theory, finding out there's an expert shortage, and like starting to think about how shapes matter. And I got hooked. And so the work got a lot of traction. Now our lab is something like 12 people working on this stuff. And I think we're in position to really have an influence in the census cycle. And I hope that influence will not just be on litigation, but will be on the kind of reform movement and on the policy, on the side that writes policy, not just the side that goes to court over it. So anyway, thanks for asking. It's good to remember, like, I got into this stuff because there's a need, and I stayed in it because the math is so cool. It's actually like the questions that you need to ask to get somewhere are also just mathematically really challenging and rich. So yeah, it's a happy set of coincidences.